interesting thing about Mike is he does not have to wear a body cam. And I asked him over the weekend, I said, you know, what do you think about these body cams? It's going to be on the agenda at the commission meeting. I'm really curious. He jokingly said, you know, I think all officers should have to wear Google glasses and have their entire surveillance, you know, watched. And it's kind of egregious, but what's interesting is a 2015 study by the Department of Justice did find that federal agents don't have to wear body cams. So body cams are not good enough for federal agents. Why are they good enough for the LAPD? How are they helping the LAPD? How are they making it easier for the LAPD to control situations when they become unsafe? Or are they, in fact, opening a Pandora's box of situations in which we may not be able to explain ourselves? So also this weekend, the FBI came out with a study about de-policing. That's a new term to me. I've never heard it. It's new. It's about the effect that police officers are opting not to proactively police in the light of what they might face in retribution from doing their job. I have re-policing on my legs. Re-policing. Because I'm really asking and hoping the LAPD comes back to re-police. I would love it. If you guys just got to do your jobs, it would make LA so much better for everyone. And thank you, Charlie Beck, for listening. I appreciate it. Have a good one.
Ahmed Khan.
Good morning, Sunny. Thanks for sharing the link.
I have this term by Craig Uchida, systematic social observation. And I'm trying to understand what he really means by that. Of course, coming from a person who gave us the laser program and the chart to assassinate people in the city of Los Angeles. But I think the question that I have is that what I didn't hear from this panel, any of the questions that where does body camera fit into the larger system of LAPD and its architectural surveillance? Taser Exxon, the supplier of body camera, has found body camera to be such a money-making machine that they've even changed the name of the company from Taser to Exxon International. They just did that 2 months ago. The reason why they're doing that is that with the advancement in the facial recognition and biometrics technology, real-time facial recognition, the body camera provides a key element, a key tool to scan people. It's a 24/7 tool of surveillance. What Exxon also found was, now increasingly with the work on artificial intelligence and predictive algorithms, that body cameras, and this is what they're saying, that body cameras are going to be a tool where they will be able to predict criminality of a particular person. When you link it up with facial recognition, you should see that. I mean, Shane Goldsmith, you have this quizzical look on your face. Read this thing. That is what we keep on asking. You ask these questions. When are you going to ask these questions? That 20 years from now, 10 years from now, 5 years from now, in conjunction with the Los Angeles Strategic Extraction and Restoration Program, in conjunction with the Suspicious Activity Reporting Initiative, in conjunction with various other programs that the LAPD has, what tool and what benefit and how does the body camera fit into this system? And I think it again reflects a complete failure of this body to ask real questions from these people and yet allowing Exxon Company to make millions and millions and millions of dollars, because Exxon also announced that they are going to give body cameras for free. They're going to donate these body cameras to police departments. The only reason being is the bottom line, and you and I, all of us, are going to be targeted by that.
Yes,
Black lives do matter. Black voices matter. And your body cameras and use of force policies and your tinkering around the edges will not change the fundamental fact that the LAPD and the economic system that it enforces does not see black lives as valuable. They see them as surplus humanity to be contained in ghettos and warehoused in private prisons. This is a fact. And Operation Laser has affected a close friend of mine recently who was walking his 8-year-old son at a park on a Sunday. And for no reason, a squad car pulled up and told him to get up against the wall in front of his 8-year-old son. When he asked them why, do you have to do this in front of my son? They pushed him harder against the wall and said, shut up or we'll take your son and throw him in the system. Now they let him go. He wasn't doing anything wrong. But yes, he is an ex-con. And yes, he does suspect he was being watched for possibly that reason. And he had to tell his son, who asked him, why did they do that, Daddy, his 8-year-old son? He had to have that conversation. Son, we're black. And when you're black in this country, you are always a suspect. So you are not. The LAPD is not a business of law enforcement. It is a business of poverty governance. It is a business of mass incarceration, of slavery and murder. And it's going to end.
And you know what else, Jed? They also did that to Michael Bodie.
Mm-hmm. Hear you, Michael Bodie. Hear you, Michael Bodie.
We're going to defend him, too.
So one of the most outrageous things about this whole body camera rollout fiasco is the amount of money and resources it's taking away from the communities. And that is a true concern. $69 million is the amount that it is projected to cost, and that doesn't take into account the money that will be needed to store the data and to review it that we've already kind of heard you all talking about at the last meeting, and then at the focus group since then, we hear you talking about how much money is going to be needed for those systems to store the data and to review it. So we already have that on the horizon. That's another cost that's going to be coming that the community is going to have to pay for. Millions of dollars for these systems that are going to be used to further surveil and stalk people and inflict trauma on communities rather than putting that money back into the communities and actually giving it back to the people that you are inflicting trauma on the most. And when you do that, what we see is this value of, or placing the value on style over substance. And we see that a lot in this room when you all put more focus on reports and on technology and unveiling these reports and technology and rolling them out and not actually looking at research into how these are impacting the communities. So my question to you all is, where is the research on that? And I don't mean research coming from these folks who we know are bringing a extremely biased point of view, who are pushing predictive policing and keeping databases and keeping all this information again to use to further stalk people in the communities. Where's the research from independent groups or from community groups to hear about what are the programs that they actually need? That's where the money needs to be going, not to these programs.
B, Department's report, dated May 3rd, 2017, relative to the follow-up response to audits on the use of body-worn video and digital in-car video.
Thank you, for, everyone who shared the video. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning. Good morning, Chief, Inspector General, Board of Police Commissioners. I'm Commander Chris Pitcher. I'm representing the Office of Operations this morning for the body-worn video, digital in-car video update. Today with me are three bureau chiefs from Operations Central, Operations West, and Operations South bureaus. If you have any bureau-specific questions relative to this report, and I have the representative from Operations Valley Bureau. So with that, I will launch in. The preliminary facts to kind of set a context for the report today. At the time of these audits, not all geographic bureaus had body-worn video.
or digital in-car video as they were being implemented, and they continue to come online across the city. Currently, there are 4,477 body-worn video cameras currently in use in the field today. 17 of 29 areas and divisions are currently body-worn video equipped, or almost 60% of the department. And that includes the 21 geographic areas, the four traffic divisions, and Transit Services Bureau, Metropolitan Division, Security Services Division, and Training. It is anticipated that all 29 entities will be equipped with the 7,000 body-worn video cameras by February of 2018. And currently, all geographic areas have the digital in-car video except Northeast and all of the Operations Valley Bureau areas. And it is anticipated they will all be DICVS equipped by August of this year. So with that being said, as you will see from the collective audits and the inspections that we will be discussing this morning, the systems are an evolutionary process for the department as it works with the department entities, with the Inspector General, to strengthen and enhance the policies and procedures as we use them in the field. And ultimately, as we continue to review, as Dr. Yoshida said, the best practices from outside the department across the country to strengthen our system and make sure that we have the best review system implemented as possible. Going back to the prior audits, as you have requested, Audit Division has completed 5 audits as of April of 2017. I will briefly touch upon those, but in each of those audits, the first 4, Audit Division focused on the required activation of the digital in-car video system, documentation of the DICVS equipment on the officers' DFARs, the supervisory assessments of the equipment in the field and its operationality, the video completeness and the inspection of the cradle ports, the antennas. Those OSC audits covered a 4-year span. They started in 2010-11 and ended in 2014-15. And they showed, for the most part, an acceptable level of compliance for the performance objectives of 5, which we talked about earlier, of being 95%. Audit Division's most recent audit in 2014-15, which is in your report, revealed that the Operations South Bureau was in compliance with 3 of the 5 objectives we discussed, the other 2 reaching 92% and 93% compliance, respectively. For the most part, the department has experienced a growth curve in compliance rates for the performance objectives. As familiarity with the equipment and the process increases, so does the compliance rates. Included in that last audit in 2014-15 for OSP, there was an equipment findings audit conducted by Audit Division. In that audit, they focused on the operationality of the DICVS antennas specifically. That audit revealed that 75% of all of the units inspected passed, or 199 of the 264 units they looked at were in working operational order. Those units were immediately repaired and replaced, and the daily inspection of the units by the officers and supervisors is now codified and is in daily protocol to prevent the recurrence of that, in addition to the new units coming out preventing that where they can't be tampered with. That 5th audit conducted by Audit Division focused on the digital in-car videos in Operations Central Bureau. It was conducted in 2016, and that audit specifically looked at the activation of the digital in-car videos, the synchronization of the wireless microphones, the video completeness, the cradle port antennas, and the wireless antennas. That OCB audit conducted in 16 showed that every performance objective was met with the lowest performance result at 96%, all the way up to perfect. Audit Division has recently conducted an audit for Operations West Bureau for the DICVS utilization. However, that audit is still in the draft phase and is not ready yet for publication. Moving on, as you have requested, the OIG conducted a total of 4 audits to date. The first one in Southwest in 2014. That audit reviewed videos and recordings of 43 Southeast transports to ascertain whether the transports followed department policy or not. The audits from the Office of Inspector General revealed that the transports were consistently done. They were audio and video recorded in their entirety. However, they noted in that audit there were issues with the not seatbelting some of the arrestees in and the lack of intent inspections. In response to that audit, the department conducted an investigation, and it was conducted in all incidents, and training was provided and documented on common cards to address all of those issues. Additionally, the two identified areas are now part of the weekly Bureau inspection team focus during their random reviews of digital in-car video and body-worn video reviews, and it is also codified in the forthcoming draft order from operations, which will cover the responsibilities of not only the officers, but the supervisors, the watch commanders, the training coordinators, and the captains in each of the areas relative to the VA, CVS, and body-worn video operations. The second audit, conducted by the IG, focused on South Bureau in 2015, and it focused on the use of the system by officers during motor vehicle and pedestrian stops. They looked at that to see how well it provided a context and detail about the stops in terms of reviewing each of those stops for appropriateness. The Office of Inspector General found that it appeared to work well in providing the context and the ability to review the detail about those stops. However, they did find instances of delayed activation, limited video coverage, and audio issues that prevented a full evaluation of the stop. In response, the department altered its DICVS policy. It revised it, requiring officers to activate their DICVS at the initiation of the stop. And to remedy the post-stop issues, documentation has now been reaffirmed, requiring officers to support the justification of all of their stops on their EDFARs, or their daily field activity reports. It is also codified in the upcoming draft order from the Office of Operations. The third audit, mission in 2015, the Office of Inspector General found the officers were generally activating their body-worn video during the incident. However, what they did find was the positioning on the belt provided issues relative to what you could see and couldn't see on the video, and they also noted a lack of full incident identification, which created issues of tracking later on when you had to go back and look at that incident. The new generation cameras are now magnetically mounted on the uniform, preventing that issue from occurring again. They give a full view of what the officer is seeing, and also the direction for the officers now to use the full incident for each of their stops is now commonplace. It's a practice directed at roll calls on a daily basis, and it is now codified in the Office of Operations draft order that is set for release.
Do we have any issues? Sorry to interrupt, but do we have any issues with the magnet and the camera in terms of the stability?
It has fallen off a couple times, but none reported widespread that I am aware of where the Office of Operation is. We continue to look into that, but we have had a couple that have fallen off, but for the most part, right now what we're hearing is it's working. It's a better method to use.
So how are we tracking this, how are we tracking the falling off or the potential problems with respect to the magnetic mat? Because I've heard quite a lot. The feedback I've gotten is very much to the contrary with respect to the number of times that it will fall off. I understand it gets knocked off by safety belts. I observed one fall off during a just a routine, you know, sort of, I think the officer was searching at a trunk. And so I'm very curious as to the number of times that, and the kinds of issues that people
have in the field with the... Yes, ma'am. We at the Office of Operations will look into that. We will cause a, all four bureaus to report back on that and ultimately cross-staff with training division to find out any issues that we have with that and how we can move forward on this. We weren't aware of that. However, we will work with the bureaus, the bureau chiefs, to reach down into each of their geographic areas as well as traffic that are equipped with the body-worn videos to see how those are working, and if there are any issues we're not made aware of, we could push that up and work with training division to rectify that.
And are we considering, is there any consideration of a
stronger magnetic now?
That I'm not aware of, ma'am.
Hey, Commissioner T, your first question relative to the tracking. So every time we roll out to a division, we instruct them on the proper way to mount the devices. There is a right way and a wrong way for everything else. The magnets, I brought examples here. Each officer is given two magnets. The typical one that the officer wears is this X mount. This logo has to be facing forward. It will work the other way, but it does not create a good seal. And this is what we have found. Sometimes when you add this between layer between your shirt and the magnet, see how it's offset here? Actually doesn't have a solid foundation. So any lateral movement will cause it to disassociate, but if it's done correctly, has a nice solid foundation. So those are things that we make sure from the training coordinator perspective that we're making sure that they're mounting them correctly. The second thing is that we provide also a much heavier magnet mount. This is typically, and I have to be careful here because I've caught my fingers many a times on this one. This is typically used if you have an outer vest that is an approved uniform for the officers, or if you have a jacket, this is what they use to go on the outside of the jacket. It's much heavier. This is why most officers don't like using this on their uniform itself because it drags down, but it is an approved mount for the officers. In both cases, what we've asked the officers to do is if they do have issues with it, is one is to make sure that they're mounting it correctly, two, report it to us through our, we have a dedicated email system for the body-worn video system, to report it to us so that we can take a look at it. We've had anecdotal evidence of it coming off in certain times, but nothing widespread. As a matter of fact, those officers in the first five divisions that used the first mount, which is very similar to this mount here, which is a plastic mount, actually preferred this mount much better because one, it was easier to position on their uniform. It was easier to adjust it, say, up or down based on your height, your size, and positioning in the vehicle. But certainly, like with any piece of equipment, there is not a perfect system out there. However, I have not seen the kind of widespread issues that perhaps has been talked about for the magnets. Quite the opposite. It's actually been well received by the officers. We just ensure that they're mounting it correctly.
Okay, I would frankly just appreciate and we can follow up. It doesn't have to take place at this moment in this room, but I just want to put it to be clear. I would appreciate some thought given to how we might get a more systematic answer with respect to the efficiency of the mount, and also how we might communicate in be sensitive to issues around even just the strength of the magnet, stronger magnets from a personnel management perspective. There are people who are sensitive to things like batteries and magnets and cell phones and things that are, kind of on their bodies. It may be, I assume it's perfectly safe and that we know that, but we have to know, it has to be more than we know that. We have to make sure that the personnel that's being required to do this also understand that. So I'm interested in the details around how we are implementing this technology. And I know that we've ramped it up and rolled it out in a pretty rapid manner, given the size, the scope, the scale of what we're doing in Los Angeles, and we've got a lot of pieces to manage around it, and we are just beginning some of that, but this is one that I don't want to get lost in the midst of all of the other things that we're managing as it relates to the cameras themselves.
Yeah, absolutely, Commissioner, and I will say that prior to rolling out any of the particular amounts, not only do we do the internal testing just for wearability and usability and those kind of things. But we also did, and we're very keenly aware of the fact that we're going to use magnets. And there's the warnings that we've worked with Taser Axon now to understand its effects. And in fact, this plastic mount that I have here, the reason this mount exists is because certainly if you have a pacemaker, putting a magnet on your chest is not an appropriate thing to do. It's part of the warning. This particular mount has no magnets on it. So if we come across one, which we have within the organization, we make sure that they get this mount versus the magnet mount, and they're well educated and understand that piece of it. So certainly there's always more work to do, and we'll continue to do so. Issues with where the camera positioning, as you well know,
off any of those issues. We work hand in hand with them to make sure that we're understanding those issues. And every time that does come up, we go back and we work with them to ensure that we're gathering that data for that purpose. But we'll continue to monitor and report back as required.
And the department has the same current concerns as the commission does on this. You know, we are working with Taser Axon and other vendors to make sure we have the best equipment available. You know, truthfully, the cameras are too big. They're state of the art, but they're too big. And as they get smaller, this will become less of an issue.
That's really good.
Thank you.
Part of my question, Dan, you know, in 5 years, what's a 5-year camera?
Yeah, I suspect in 5 years, Commissioner, that it will be much smaller, it'll be much more efficient. The great leap in technology right now is everybody's waiting for the batteries to get better. When the batteries get better, the devices will get smaller. When that happens, we'll be able to get the 14 hours that we require out of these devices in a much smaller platform, which will give us more options for mounting, more options to secure it. And we're working closely with the manufacturers to push that agenda and to make sure that, as the Chief mentioned, that we're having the state-of-the-art technology and mounting options.
And how about technology for automatically turning the cameras on? I mean, there's so much stress and so many things that are going on. We're training it into people, but the new technology could make it a lot easier.
Yeah, certainly.
Are they working on that?
Yes. So as part of the original purchase of the equipment, we actually purchased a device that allows it for the devices to turn on once the light bar is activated. We purchased that early, knowing that they were in the finishing stages. We're actually doing that testing today. So the short answer is when you turn on your light bar at position 2 or position 3, which is required for all stops, it would then send a signal to the cameras to automatically turn on. One less thing for the officers to do as they get out of the vehicle to deal with whatever's in front of them. The other thing is that you may have heard several vendors, including Axon, are working on technology that addresses removing the weapon from your holster and things like that. We are also looking at those, all very early stages. Certainly nothing I would recommend at this point to the Chief or to the body. Certainly we are not only working with them and participating in the discussion, but we're getting all the early technology to be able to take a look at it, understand it, make recommendations when they're still in the development stages as opposed to getting something at the end.
Thank you, sir.
Getting back to the audits that the Bureau requested, or the Board rather requested, the fourth and last of the Office of Inspector General audits was in 2015, and it focused on Central Bureau, specifically Central Area, Central Traffic, and Newton, and they evaluated the officer compliance with body-worn video and digital in-car video operational policies, specifically the seatbelting of arrestees and recording the entire transport throughout. The Office of Inspector General found that in 84%, they had activated the video for the entire transport, and 88% of the time, the transports seatbelted the arrestees during transport. Again, they also commented on the belt mounting body-worn video impact in terms of quality of view. The new generation cameras, as we talked about earlier, resolve those quality issues, and the seat belting of arrestees obviously is department policy. However, it has become a focal point of the random audits that are conducted by the Bureau inspection units in their random reviews of both body-worn and digital in-car videos. So in January of 2016, the department, in its effort to further strengthen the body-worn video and digital in-car video systems in the field, Bureau inspection units were implemented in each of the four bureaus with the responsibility of randomly reviewing all body-worn video, or rather random samples of all body-worn video and digital in-car video footage to check for compliance with the critical body-worn video and digital in-car video operations. But as you have seen in the report, the inspection objectives were not standardized for all bureaus at the time, and therefore they varied somewhat as to the areas that they looked at from bureau to bureau. They have been informally standardized, as you will see in my next audit from Office of Operations, or Inspection rather, for the bureaus, and they are currently being documented in an upcoming order to ensure consistency across the entire city from bureau to bureau. In fact, the draft order that's getting ready for publication delineates the specific inspection methodology for both digital in-car video and body-worn video bureau inspection units to follow when conducting their inspections. So we'll be exactly the same across the city from bureau to bureau. So when we look at the now for follow-up, when we find body-worn video and or digital in-car video, anomalies, performance, failures, we have a whole list of terms that we use interchangeably. Non-compliance, performance anomalies, performance deficits, discrepancies are all synonymous with non-compliance with the policy. But when we find those and they're identified by the bureau inspection teams, those bureau inspection teams forward to the involved areas those issues. They are bookmarked, the digital in-car video and body-worn video footage is sent there, and they are required to conduct a full investigation into the matter and take action as appropriate. The current area response right now to a body-worn video or digital in-car video anomaly is the provision of training by the supervisor or training coordinator to correct the behavior to ensure that it doesn't continue. And it is documented on a comment card and kept for future tracking purposes as we monitor the individuals moving forward. The Office of Operations, as you requested, we conducted a random bureau video inspection covering a six-month period, snapshots covering October 2016 through March 2017 of this year. And each of those bureau inspection units looked at, and I will talk about the issues here, but the synchronization of microphones, the video inspection, they looked at the activation of videos, the video completeness and deactivation, they looked for the uploading of videos and the seatbelting of suspects during transport. And here were the results by bureaus. Operation South Bureau, they looked primarily at the body-worn videos, the inspections. They looked at 14,361 items or incidents, and they found 265 of those incidents to be out of compliance. They had an overall compliance rating of 98% for the random in-car video and body-worn video review. Operation Censure Bureau, they looked at, because they had both, they looked at digital in-car video and body-worn video. They looked at 10,572 separate incidents. Of those, they found 555 of them out of compliance for one reason or another. They achieved a 95% overall compliance rate for the six-month period that they reviewed, and it was reviewed month by month by month. And when you look at the performance standards, each of those performance standards were equal in weighting. None was weighted more than the other. Out of the six, they were all compiled for the month, and each of those months were compiled for the six-month period to give us the overall average of compliance.
In the future, I think it would actually be beneficial to have the percentages by item, not in aggregate.
Yes, sir. We can look at the chart and break it down. Included in your reports is a detailed chart of each of the bureau inspections as to what they looked at specifically. I am in, for purposes of timeliness, synopsizing for you. Operations West Bureau, they looked at only digital in-car video system performance. Essentially, that's all they had. Only one has body-worn video at the time. They looked at 3,242 separate incidents, of which 755 were out of compliance. They achieved an overall compliance rating for the six-month period of 77%. Operations Valley Bureau, they looked at body-worn video, as they do not have any digital in-car video as of yet. They are scheduled at the end of this month to receive their first digital in-car video in Devonshire at the end of May. They looked at, in their bureau inspection units, 7,617 separate incidents. Of those, 552 were out of compliance, giving them a six-month overall compliance rating of 93%. Common issues identified by each of the four bureaus collectively were failing to sync the microphones at the start of watch. They had late activations. They had non-activations. They did not properly document the contact later in their DFARs. They had the DICVS upload issues that were found in these inspections. the improper use or non-use of seatbelts of arrestees and mislabeled videos, which made it difficult for later reviews. These issues are all specifically addressed for correction in the pending operations order, which is called the Procedures for Digital In-Car Video System. And as discussed before, it is anticipated that the OWB compliance rating, as you see, is 77%, will increase with greater familiarity with the system as it was new to them, and the equipment, as evidenced by the fact that the Bureau performed far better in the non-categorical use of force inspection, which we will discuss in a minute, achieving a performance objective compliance in a limited inspection of 94%. On to the non-categorical use of force inspections, what the Office of Operations directed each Bureau was to look at the non-categorical uses of force for the last five that were investigated and completed prior to May 1st of 2017. And in each of those five inspections, the bureaus were told to look for, were the officers equipped with body-worn video or DACVS, was the first question. If equipped, was it properly activated prior to the incident? If the equipment was not activated, was the rationale for not doing so, was it reasonable and justifiable? And then finally, what administrative action was taken when it was appropriate to take administrative action under the given circumstances, and what action was taken to remedy that. In terms of the five for Office or Operation South Bureau, they looked at 31 separate incidents. 27 of those were digital in-car videos, and 7 were body-worn videos. And remember that Operation South Bureau only has body-worn videos in the harbor right now. So that was the low issue there for looking at it. They achieved a 91% compliance rate, and it was found that in all of the areas of non-compliance, the officers received supervisory counseling and training in every case that was documented. In Operation Sensor Bureau, they reviewed 30 overall. Of those 30, 23 were from the digital in-car video, and 25 were body-worn video. They achieved an 81% overall compliance rate, and in all of the cases of non-compliance with policy, supervisory training was provided in all instances, and it was documented properly on a comment card for later tracking. Operations West Bureau, they reviewed 30 separate cases. Of those 30, 28 were digital in-car video. 4 of those were from the body-worn video. Of that, Operations West Bureau, as we spoke about, achieved a 94% overall compliance in this limited inspection. And when they had their issues of non-compliance with policy, the training was provided by a supervisor and a debrief, and they were a comment card was completed in all instances for further tracking purposes. Last but not least, for the five non-categorical use of force inspections, Operations Valley Bureau, they reviewed 15 overall. All were from body-worn video, as, of course, Valley Bureau does not have digital in-car video yet. They had an 87% compliance rating. And in those areas where they had performance deficits, counseling was provided by a supervisor in all incidents, and it was documented on a comment card for future tracking. And the department, in addition to the audit division audits, the Office of Inspector General audits, as well as the ones that are directed by the Office of Operations in terms of the Bureau of Inspections.
We need a public audit, independent right. of the police yes. department. Right.
The department is taking additional actions to improve adherence to the body-worn video and digital in-car video policies and procedures to strengthen the performance and review in the field. First, in terms of training division, body-worn and digital in-car video has been implemented into recruit instruction in their block, where they receive a 4-hour block. That started in January of 2017. They receive all of the policies, procedures, directives. They are told how to operate the equipment and everything related to the operational issues of digital in-car video and body-worn video. Second, the Office of Operations, we talked about, we have drafted two all-encompassing orders delineating all of the responsibilities
of officers, supervisors, watch commanders, training coordinators, and commanding officers relative to DICB and body worn video operations and responsibilities to ensure that, that we don't have these issues recurring in the future. We are also currently drafting a notice standardizing the Bureau review process for the digital in-car video and body worn video footage to ensure consistency of review across the city from bureau to bureau to bureau to ensure that the issues of non-compliance and the methods of tracking are standardized and available for to grab the later date. And then the last thing the department is doing is we have a visual aid, Tell Your Story. It's a sticker that, that reminds the officers to activate their body-worn videos. As of now, it is in all of the Operations Central Bureau black and white vehicles. The 1,500 stickers were purchased and delivered to the department last week, and they will be, over the next couple of weeks, installed in all black and white vehicles across the city, reminding the officers visually to activate those body-worn videos. And as you heard from Dr. Uchida, as you previously stated, the department continues to look at outside studies, research, and we look at other departments who use body-worn video and digital in-car video for the best practices for implementation to ultimately strengthen everything that we have within the department here. So I'm completed with the response and available for your questions.
Thank you.
Can you talk a little bit about the issue that the department is having with the PPL, the notification process?
I have Commander Alberca here to talk about. She's from Employee Relations Group. She can address all of those issues a little bit better than I can, as she is talking with the league about those issues now.
So currently, with respect to the police agent trying to make us look bad,
excuse me, can we please have one? Thank you.
Order. We're currently in a meet and confer in order how we can memorialize those so that the officer has a right to respond. There's a penal process that the officer's entitled to. So we're currently working on the best form of documentation to allow that due process for the employee to respond.
And in the meantime, are these failure to comply, are those still being documented and reported? What's happening with, in this interim period, what's happening with these failures to comply?
Correct. As Commander Fisher indicated, the current process would be to memorialize them in a common clerk. That's what's being done in the respective bureaus.
And so once we get through the confer process, I'm just concerned about how they're actually, whether they're a part of the record or not a part of the record right now.
They are part of the record right now.
Yes.
Comment card is the beginning of the progressive discipline system, and we track comment cards. There is an opportunity for comment cards to fall off an individual's record after a certain amount of time, should there be no reoccurrence. But comment cards are the beginning. If there are reoccurrences, we have been at times used a greater form of discipline.
So what exactly in the process is suspended right now?
The department had considered the use of an action item that would be associated with the employee's change report. However, because the retention of that particular avenue to memorialize it is different than the existing comment card, that's one aspect that has caused it to be suspended, as well as an action item does not allow the employee the opportunity to respond as it does with an existing comment card. So those are the two primary issues that we're going to meet and confer with the league to determine an ultimate resolution for that, that will allow for a proper tracking system and the employee's response.
Okay, thank you. Commander Pitcher, on page 7, there were two divisions, Southwest and 77th, that had issues with damaged transmitters. One rubber coating coming off, and I note that that was it was pretty significant in each of those divisions. But yet, in Harbor and South Traffic, they did not have that issue at all. Is this an indicator that the damage was intentional?
Just break the damn antenna.
I can bring the deputy chief if you'd like to have him speak specifically to the issue and the actions taken.
That'd be great, thank you.
You said they broke the antenna.
Good morning, everybody. I believe that was in 2014-15, and those were the first generation of microphones that we had. With the constant use, and I can tell you that Southwest and 77th are far busier divisions. There's a lot more activity in South Traffic and Harbor. And those antennas, and I remember when the officers had them, those antennas were being brushed up against, the tips would come off, and then the antennas had no coverage, and they were sticking into the officers and tearing their uniforms. That has been corrected through two ways. First, we've implemented constant supervisory checks of those every day, and they have been upgraded to where they no longer have those same tips on them. And I think if we look at more recent inspections, it's greatly improved.
And if the commission wants more on that, Sergeant Gorman is available. He did a lot of work on the antennas on the uniform.
So, quickly, commissioners, yes, the early generation were in fact rubbing off. It was just a simple kind of like a wax coating, rubber coating that would go over it, and the antennas did not have a swivel on it. And that little simple device of a swivel just meant that they were constantly in the same position, the constant wearing off. And because they started to snag on the officer's uniform, they would just start to essentially peel apart. The new generations actually have a pivot swivel on it, so they move, they bend with the officers, they aren't rubbing off. We've had great success with that, and in fact, we've had two generations since then. And in fact, every year that the next generation comes out, the coating is better, and we have less and less issues associated with it.
So I won't belabor the point, but we need to make sure that we are making sure that whether it's digital in car video or the body worn, that they're not being intentionally damaged. Obviously, this was 2014, 2015, so it was quite a bit of time ago. But honestly, you have in Harbor, you had 107 of these devices and zero issues. In South Traffic, you had 20, you had one issue. In 77, you had 56. You had 97 of these devices, and you had 41 issues. And that's
so I can add one thing to that, Commissioner, is I can tell you that, and actually part of us working with Harbor Division, is Harbor actually was the first one to really kind of take this bull by the horn, so to speak, and they were actually replacing the rubber coating on their own, which is why they weren't reporting them. But whether the device had the coating or not, it did not affect the performance of the antenna in any way, shape, or form. The antenna, the coating was simply that, it was just a way of stopping.
Please have quiet in the audience.
Beck, you should investigate
this. Please have quiet in the audience.
You can investigate it, hold it here.
The coating is simply that. It's essentially a steel wire underneath. That's all it is. It's underneath it. So that steel wire is what snags on the uniform, which is why the rubber coating is there to begin with. Even absent the rubber coating, it didn't act as any performance inhibitor to the devices themselves.
What are you going to do down there?
And the department, of course, commissioners are extremely sensitive to this. And
yeah, right.
If we saw any indication that there was intentional tampering, it would lead to significant discipline.
What did you do last time? What did you do last time? Nothing.
Did you take your word for that?
Word
of
peace.
Bullshit.
Mr.
Bullshit.
Khan, can you please stop disrupting the meeting?
Right.
Uh-oh.
Other questions, please?
Bullshit.
Get specific on certain killing and murders of unarmed black and brown youth. Get specific.
Any other questions?
Yeah. No.
Do we have any public comment on this item?
Yes, sir. We have five public comment cards. We have Audrey George, Pastor Q, Karen Hall, Shane Dolfman, Kamek Khan, and Akili.
I put it in a public comment.
It's not in public comment yet.
Hi. It would be refreshing to get some honesty about
The intent for body cams and in-car cams, which are not, I don't think any, very many of the civilian population in this room believe that those are really intended to increase accountability.
Not at all.
Of the police. They are merely another way that we will be surveilled. They intersect with all the other means that are used to contain neighborhoods of color, victimize and marginalize them, and criminalize them.
Right.
It all intersects. Even the company that's providing the body cameras shows its intent, states its intent for these the footage to be used to help with predictive policing.
Yeah.
It's on and record that they have said that. So all of this is just intersectional way of criminalizing the neighborhoods. The police are going to go into those neighborhoods expecting to see crime.
Yes.
They will see crime because they're expecting to see crime. We all know that's how the mind works, and the police are incentivized to use all of their militarized equipment, and they will. They will use all of their toys against the people.
Church Without Walls, Black Jewish Justice Alliance, Black and Brown Clergy and Community Coalition. At first, Texas cops claimed they shot and killed 15-year-old Jordan Edwards because he was in a car driving in an aggressive manner towards an officer. But Box Springs Police Chief Jonathan Haber has since said that the car was driving away from the officers because the cop fired, killing the teen who was riding passenger in a car driven by his brother. Haber said this after viewing the body cam footage that still has not been made public, but it might, being that the police was forthcoming. My question is, what if the chief would not have been forthcoming?
Yeah.
What if the department would have decided to alter that video? What if the officer would not have turned on the body cam?
Mm-hmm.
We're moving as if trust is on the table, but it's not. For example, in your report, sir, you mentioned an issue with lack of full incident on body cams, which means what? Are they turning them on when it's convenient?
Yeah.
Listen, it's clear you want more technology, but we know that black and brown communities have historically been more heavily and negatively policed than any other communities.
That's right.
We know that it has not worked. So we don't want to put more money into technology. We want to put resources into fixing issues that causes crime in black and brown communities.
Yeah.
Furthermore, Eric Garner was caught on video. No justice. Philando Castile was caught on video. No justice. 12-year-old Tamar Rice was caught on video. No justice. Charlie Africa was caught on video. No justice. The beating of Rodney King 25 years ago was caught on video. No justice. There is an audit, and that's the audit. Video cameras will not change ghetto conditions. Additionally, video cameras will not fix institutional racism. Now let's get to it and be beating around the bush.
There's a lot of truth in those words.
You know, also the attack on Michael Bodie in September of last year was caught on camera. No justice. He was picked up during a raid. No justice.
And one of the things that deeply disturbed me at last week's meeting was the conversation about body cameras, specifically the time and resources that are soon going to be required to parse and store, review, analyze the masses of data that are going to be gathered. I dive a little bit more inside then and again today, hearing what's beginning to be the layers upon layers and layers of bureaucracy built and that will soon be funded around body cameras that are actually going to do nothing, as people have said, about solving the problem of police murders, lack of accountability, lack of resources, and the black and brown communities continuing over policing. Body cameras are another sleight of hand and obfuscation. They do nothing, will do nothing, but drain resources from the communities where they're most needed. And I would ask that the PD and the city consider not throwing more good money after bad money and putting that money where they're really needed in the communities that need jobs and resources to develop and the over-policing and occupation that's happening in those communities.
Yeah.
And then Vaughn, followed by McKinney.
This is the last two?
Yes.
So let's just see what the body cameras will do. So this is the Taser CEO, Rick Smith, talking to the media, saying we've got all this law enforcement info with these videos, which is one of the richest treasure troves you could imagine for machine learning. His VP, Steve Tuckle, goes to say that body cameras provide a tremendous opportunity for video streaming into its servers. Now remember, Exxon is giving body cameras for free to every police department in the country. I mean, imagine in this monopoly, brutal, ruthless capitalist system, any company giving anything for free. This is where they're going. Rick Smith, the CEO of Exxon, goes on to say, and this is a reference to RoboCops, and he says to realize the fully futuristic dimension of RoboCops, where you essentially have someone wearing an exoskeleton linked to advanced artificial intelligence capabilities. So what they will do is linking up with predictive analytics, linking up with facial recognition technology, linking up with biometrics technology, and here you have the same old bullshit that Craig Uchida and his gang and these people keep on giving up to us, that machines are race neutral. Machines are not racist. Machines just tell us where to go. Well, when you feed the same information from racist policing, it's garbage in, garbage out. Blackface goes in, blackface comes out. Blackface is confronted, blackface is murdered. So this is where we are going with this whole thing. And none of these people, Steve Stoberoff, he was saying, they're all stressed out. Well, of course, what did they do? And now Beck was talking about a strict punishment. Where was Beck when they broke off 92 antennas out of 300 patrol cars? People know that, right? They're going back to 2014. Nothing happened, to the extent that TFANG is documented and saying in emails internally that the command staff abdicated its responsibility. This is where we are going with this thing. So keep an eye on that.
Could you stop disturbing the meeting, please?
This puts me in the mind of what Malcolm X said. You stick a knife in my back and pull it out 6 inches, and I'm supposed to be pleased at that. That's progress. No. This is the distraction. This is a way to turn us from what is really happening. This is the equivalent of putting a Band-Aid on cancer and saying we're trying to treat it. Don't be misled by this body camera stuff. You heard Pastor Q, he ticked off all the people who we saw on video and still nothing happened. Eric Gardner, and I can tick off more. It still didn't hold y'all accountable. It still made no difference. We could see with our eyes, the world saw with their eyes, what you did, and still there was no accountability, no consequence. Listen, if you really want to do something about the use of force, prosecute police. Woo! Start holding them accountable. Reduce and make real. And make real this so-called ruling out of policy. Right now, all you got to do is blink, and you are in policy. Because I thought they was going to do something. So this camera stuff is poor, unadulterated. Bullshit. Anybody want to say it?
Bullshit!
Say that! And you know it. So don't get off on that. Don't be tricked. Don't get off on that. And the reason we are here today is to remind you that it's bullshit.
Yeah.
Yeah. on this item?
I'll move approval.
A couple of things I'd like to.
Last thing we need to hear is that report. So
that's right.
That's not what we need or.
Sir.
Okay, Marquisha Wilson, stand it! Marquisha Wilson,
stand it! Do not do that! Do not do that! Do not do that! Don't you do that to me!
Watch your hands.
I fucking spent still days in front of that bullshit! Don't you do that to me!
F-O-I, fool! That's right!
You beat up an old man!
Blue, red!
Shit.
Let's watch defense. Keep an eye on defense.
He was just speaking the truth!
Can everybody please have a seat?
You can't take the truth!
Watch yourself!
Fuck yourself! Fucking liar!
Empire fall.
Yeah!
Everybody back from security.
What's so fun?
All right, boss. We got to go back to the security.
You weren't like watching. This is bullshit, you know that. This is bullshit, you all were watching. You saw who came out, you saw who was here, and now you want to force people back through security. This is bullshit.
I just went through this an hour ago. I've been in here. There's no way I could have gotten anything from inside after I went through security. It's logically persistent.
Funny how the law changes like every week.
Is that your jacket?
No, it's not.
Or does it belong to
somebody? Leave a jacket.
The young lady in white.
Maybe Jada.
Oh yeah.
The young lady in white.
Jada, are your jackets here?
1 second, ma'am, please.
I'm waiting till there's room for me to pass through. I'm not fucking safe. What the fuck kind of jungle is this? Circus, that's what it is. You're running a circus, Matt Johnson.
they can reach this out.
Of course, they changed the rules. They actually let us go in the lobby. They usually don't let us go out the door.
We saw the LAPD protect the racist.
Different fucking law every week.
White supremacist, racist, Trumpites. We saw them protect them from peaceful protesters.
Yep, you were one of them. Yep. Don't think about that at all. Really long. He doesn't laugh at you when you're gone at all.
If a peaceful protester is brown or
right
black, they're
like,
considered
the
criminals by the LAPD.
All right, listen, if you do not leave right now, you will not be allowed back into the room. If you leave right now, you'll be allowed back in. All right?
Whose order is that?
By order
that
of the police
your
division,
order?
Yes. If you do not leave right now, you will not be allowed back into the room.
You are the top guy.
Where's your supervisor at?
I'm the supervisor.
No, where's the captain?
I'm the supervisor.
No. Where's your supervisor?
Yeah. He's not here right now.
Can you call Mark? Yeah.
No.
You guys got that on tape?
You can't call
That's
him.
That's a violation of the Brown Act.
My supervisor, if someone asked that, we have to call them.
Aren't
have
you
to
legally
do
obligated?
So you don't want to do your job?
Nope, I'm not calling. I don't need to call anybody right now, okay?
Oh, sorry.
So if you don't, not leave the room.
Yeah, you don't want us to
yet.
Sit here.
Punk ass.
You don't want to hear.
You're a real punk ass.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Oh, how you doing?
Yeah.
How you doing? Good. Good to see you.
Yeah.
Hey. This guy here is filming me.
Y'all be
shaming
yourself.
Ooh,
touching you. Go
Do
ahead.
You need to be Go. 6 inches behind my arm?
You need to leave this.
Do you
this
need
area?
To be 6 inches behind my arm? So why did I have to go through when I stepped in the lobby last time?
Once they adjourn it, you can come back in. I've been advised that once they come back in, as long as you don't leave the lobby, you can go right back.
You've been advised by your supervisor that was not there?
So why was it that when we came in the lobby 5 minutes ago, we had to go through security again?
I will bring one as soon as I can.
Because the law changed in 5 minutes?
Okay, hey, this is the guy who shot Morris.
How many people did you shoot? Hey, now we're here in the lobby of the LAPD headquarters in downtown. Oh, we're across the street from City Hall. I don't know why the room was cleared. I was in the lobby at the time going through security whenever that.
Come back now.
Where again?
She'll
are you from Internal Affairs?
She'll take a complaint for you.
I'm a supervisor. I wish to talk to you, yes.
No. Are you from Internal Affairs?
I'm from Family Aid 1-7.
You guys call the captain from Internal Affairs, please. Get him over here.
Police.
You can't take a claim against a lieutenant.
On the back of this car?
Huh?
On the back of this car? Phone
no, no. I'm asking you to call Internal Affairs so I can file a complaint. No, I don't want your card. I want the captain's card. I want you to call the captain and have him come down here and take a complaint. No, that's a direct award.
You all can meet in the break room.
Down at the station. Two police agents.
Okay, you think I'm playing? You're a violation.
Mr. T-Fan, we are, sir. Yes, please, thank you. So that concludes the circumstances of the Austin Post shooting yesterday. I think that the...
I don't think I heard the first part.
...commission and the public to know...
Oh, is that...
...the use of the helicopter as a platform from which to shoot is taught and trained to a very select cadre of officers assigned to SWAT. It requires the approval of a staff-level officer. In this case, it was an assistant chief. Requires very specific criteria that have to be met regarding terrain, regarding weather, regarding the threat to the community, regarding the other options that have been utilized and that proven effective. It appears that those criteria were met. Obviously, there will be further review of this to ensure that, but it is not something that we do as a routine or in a matter that it is, by any stretch of imagination, undisciplined. So, I think that's those things that need to be said and are important for the commission to know about. And if the commission is interested, I know that many of you have seen the training that's conducted for aerial platform shooting. But if a presentation is warranted, obviously the department would be glad to do that. This is something we've been training monthly on since for over 10 years. And first time it's been implemented. 2017 Mayor's Gun Buyback will be conducted this Saturday between the hours of 10 to 2 p.m. There will be two locations, one at the Memorial Sports Arena downtown, 3939 South Figueroa, and the other at the Facing Medical Group in San Fernando Valley at 11165 Sepulveda. As in years past, We'll be purchasing unwanted handguns, really important. Many of the guns used in crime in the city of Los Angeles, including all forms of crime, but specifically gang-related crime, are guns that are stolen from residences, unwanted guns, guns that are either unsecured or otherwise made available to people that burglarize homes. Perfect example was the officer-involved shooting yesterday. Had the police department responded in a slower fashion
Most certainly, that individual would have taken as his loot from the burglary multiple handguns of the victim. As released to crime, and these are statistics as of the 6th of this month. Homicides down 2%, rapes down 11.9%, robberies up 3.6%, aggravated assaults down 3.0%, total violent crime down 1.4% from last year. Total property crime, just the opposite, up 1.4% from last year. Because we have much more property crime than violent crime, that gives us an aggregate of a 0.8% increase, in other words, less than 1% increase over last year. Numbers of victims shot are down slightly. We have seen a reduction in the overall gang crime of 9.5%. We have recovered 1,542 guns so far year to date. That's 8.3% greater than 16 and 21% greater than the 5-year average. Traffic statistics, we're up about 2% in total traffic accidents over last year, 18,000 compared to 17,900. Fatalities are up 9.5%. We've had 81 fatalities so far. To give you an idea how that compares to homicide, we're at our 98th homicide so far year to date. Driving under the influence is down 9.8%. Hit and runs are down 1.2%. Motor vehicle versus pedestrian are down overall, but motor vehicle versus pedestrians that result in fatalities are up significantly, 49%. 49 this year compared to 34 last year. That's a total of 44% increase. One of the reasons we stress pedestrian violations in our traffic enforcement is just this. Distracted driving and pedestrian violations are the two major contributors to this, as is overall vehicle speed. Bicycle-involved traffic collisions are down 14%. And the serious bicycle-involved traffic collisions that result in death or injury are down almost 28%. We have 9,950 sworn personnel on payroll, 2,849 civilian personnel on payroll, about 400 reserves, 285 specialist volunteers, 57 counselors, and 8,411 cadets in the program. And that concludes my report.
Chief, that's the number of guns that are taken off the street, does that include when they have those buybacks, when we do the buyback of guns?
The numbers that I quote to you do not include the buyback numbers.
So they
never include the buyback numbers. These are guns taken in criminal investigation.
Thank you. Any other questions?
We have 6 common cards. We have the red Chief Hunt, followed by Paula Miner and Eddie H. The Red Chief. Paula Miner.
Hold on.
Here's what I gotta say to the Chief of Police. Fucked up when you came after my job. You really fucked up. And let me tell you why. Because community-based policing comes from jobs. You finally got me off the beach, so it's personal now. You fuck with my job, you fuck with my daughter, that's personal. You did both of those too. I know how to fuck with you guys. Real bad. Matt Johnson, you're a statistic in this matter. But you come after my kids, you come after my daughter, I take it very personal. And let me tell you why. Because you arrested me 86 times for working on the beach. And that's fucked up. Working, selling soap, not dope. You know, that's really fucked up. Been to the Ninth Circuit, been to District Court. I take that very, very personal. So with me and you, get out of line with me and they fuck up, I'm holding you accountable for it. And trust me, I have a team of professionals that can hold you guys accountable for what your action does. So everything's gonna reflect back on you. You should have never brought me down here. Yes. Whatever he says, no matter. Whatever the federal court says, matter. And that's the truth. And if you guys haven't learned that yet, you guys haven't read LA Times. Trust me on this, Chief Bear. I'm holding you accountable for everything. I'm down here now. For the next 3 years, I'm down here. I can do it. I have a team of professionals. Dr. Swinger trained me just to do that.
Hello, Mayor.
Agent.
Chief Beck.
Hold on, stop the time for a second. Whoever's phone is done watching, please stop it. Yeah.
Okay, Chief Beck, recently I saw you in an independent film. Your comments were on Facebook, and I also saw the film, I believe it was on Showtime or whatever. In any case, you were asked by the interviewer about racial profiling and racial bias. And you said early on in your career, you worked undercover and you had long hair. You said you were stopped hundreds of times by LAPD until you cut your hair. Then the stop ceased. Chief Beck, you also said that those of us who are stopped need to carry empathy in our hearts and to show empathy when an officer is stopping us. And these are your comments. I may be paraphrasing, but you know that's what you said. Chief Beck, I could not believe that you equated long hair with ethnicity. We cannot cut our skin off when we get tired of the 100 stops. We cannot look the way you and LAPD prefer so that you won't stop us or that so our stops won't be deadly. It makes no sense for you to have said, have empathy. How did we show empathy? Did Ezell Ford fail to have empathy? Did Redell Jones fail to have empathy? Did Brother Africa fail to have empathy? I felt that you had an opportunity when you made that film, and I know you get to have cuts and re-say things. You had an opportunity to try to bring the community together, to say something profound, to say something that helps us understand what happens. But you chose, again, to not really have the kind of depth of understanding of what's going on. And if you at the top have that attitude, what can we expect from the day-to-day officers? And again, as I've said in this commission over and over again, the policies, we talk about all of these issues, they do not get to the street, because if the top doesn't demand it, it doesn't get there. And I'm really sad that that was what you did on that film.
Los Angeles Community Action Network. This one said that a black man or black woman is either free or they're not. There can be no apprenticeship training for freedom. You know, we talk a lot about the crimes committed by quote-unquote criminals, but Chief, in your report, you never talk about the crimes committed by your officers.
Yeah. Biggest gang.
Time and time and time and time again.
21 this year.
We come to this meeting and we expound upon the atrocities that are happening in our neighborhoods at the hands of your officers. And I just want to say to you, Chief, before I go forward, that our bodies do not belong to you or your officers. Our bodies do not belong to you to surveil, to target, and to stalk. We should be able to move in any space in this city, in this state, in this country, without worrying about the ilk of your kind. I want to raise up the name of Michael Bowie, who was arrested on trumped up charges, who is now being stalked and targeted on a daily basis by your officers. We know, Chief Beck, that this state that we live in is a police state. And you want to add to it with body cameras that we won't even be able to see the footage of. So who are you really working for, Chief? Protecting, serving who? Your officers, once again. We talk about use of force and de-escalation. I've been hearing for the last couple of weeks that I'm nauseated. Been in on daily with this, but we know as a community, on the ground floor, in our communities, that there is no de-escalation, but there's plenty of use of force in every way, shape, form, or fashion. So we say to you today, Chief, that once again, that we're tired. We're tired of the same old shenanigans, the same old song, the same old dance. But one thing we're not going to do, we're not going to dance a jig for you. And we're not going to be your boy. We're not going to allow you to be massive. Because we're going to stand up, we're going to fight back, and we're going to be undaunted. We're not going to be tired, and we're going to keep moving forward. And Matt Johnson, for you, your disrespect that you showed our elders is so unbecoming. It's egregious and reprehensible. I wouldn't do that to an elder of mine, even if I had hatred in my heart, which I know for any person. I would not disrespect an elder. But you've shown us since day one when you came into this room, you showed us disdain, disrespect, and disregard for us by reading from a report that I had to come from a Hollywood movie because it was not based in reality. For once, we want you to recognize and understand that this is real.
Thank you for your comments.
Our heartfeltness is real. And we will be here week in, week out, month in, month out, year in, year out, whether you get it or not. Because this cognitive dissonance that you guys do the job with is appalling. It's not understandable. Thank you.
So I want to report on what Pig Beck is not reporting this morning. Because we know that you function in secrecy. Everything that you do is in secret, out of the public eye. On March 2nd, LAPD, under Beck here, did a raid. And this raid actually was in the Leimert Park, Baldwin Hills, Crenshaw community, also known as the Jungles. I know, again, you've visited my home, so it's actually where I live. And during this raid, they picked up 4 senior citizens. Four scary senior citizens. They're so scary, seniors. Also, we've heard the name of Michael Bodie. They picked up someone that I know who's a leader in the community. Before we talk about Michael, I want to name the other senior citizens that were terrorized. Clyde Bailey, 79 years old. Vincent Payne, 66 years old. Michael Lofton, 62 years old. This brother is still in jail. He's still in jail. Kenneth Harrison, 61 years old. Are they supposed to die in jail? What are they supposed to do? What are their family members supposed to do? Michael Bodie, 37 years old, father of a 4-year-old, a 6-year-old, a 17-year-old, with SWAT in his home, with guns in front of his 4-year-old child. That's what Beck isn't reporting. Tell the truth. Tell the truth. We know you're working with the city. We know you're working with developers. We know you want to get out black and brown people under military occupation. Michael, he's all of us. You don't see the difference between us and Michael. He represents each of the 15 people you picked up.
Thank you for your
talk time. About that, Beck. Quit lying. Stop playing with our lives.
also here to talk about the use of force that we did not hear described in Beck's report, and that is to do with this individual named Michael Bodie. Michael is a beloved and well-respected member of his community and a mentor to the community's youth. Despite this, Michael regularly experiences harassment because the LAPD are determined to keep him labeled as a gang member. So what does that look like? He gets followed by police, recorded, watched by police at his job, harassed by police at his job to the point where he has to find a different job, pulled over by police for traffic stops, which escalate to the point where 15 officers have their weapons drawn on him and are pointing them at him as he has both arms clearly outside of his vehicle. This was all captured on video. This in his neighborhood in front of young children, and the reason they drew their weapons and pointed them at him like that was because he expressed being afraid of getting out of his vehicle. What else that looks like is Michael getting arrested as part of a police sweep for gang activity when actually he is not part of a gang, and being held in jail for 30 days as the judge refuses to set bail based on a report that was never signed. At the end of the 30 days, the judge admitted that he should never have been held, which is essentially like being kidnapped by the state, and Michael expressed that that's exactly what it felt like. He said he felt like he was kidnapped.
He was.
He really was. So where does Michael go to get those 30 days back?
To the Western.
What reparations will be made to his family? How will you, Charlie Beck, show your reverence for his life and the life of his children? How will you show that reverence for his life? We hear that in here all the time, and it makes us laugh. As Dr. Molina says, we laugh because to stop from crying.
Where's the
reverence for his life?
Where's the empathy?
Yeah.
Good morning. Good morning again. The scriptures declare in Proverbs, Lord, don't give me too much where I'm going. Forget about you. But again, don't give me too little to where I'm going to have to go and steal and dishonor your name. That speaks of conditions, the conditions of our community. And I know you guys want to move off of that, but we're going to stay here. This has been going on since the 40s. The Kerner Commission report, one of the most extensive reports done, told and expressed to us how to fix the conditions in our communities. We were talking about gun buybacks when I was a kid, yet we wrestled between the right to bear arms that doesn't really apply to the black community.
Yeah, that's right.
I can confidently say that the black community is tired, and we want situations and we want resources to fix the conditions in our community. We don't want to pour more than 55% of our budget into law enforcement. This policing, like I said, goes back to the 40s. Not only that, in the 70s, we had issues. And then we tried to fix it in the 90s with the crime bill. 100,000 new officers on the street. How many of them were suffering with post-traumatic stress syndrome? We criminalized drugs. And the same drugs we criminalize, now they're legal, and the folks who sold them, which were us, now they can't sell the drugs because they have a record. Same drugs. Over 2 million people, mass incarceration, over 2 million people in jail. Almost 50% of them are black. And you wonder why the black community has more policing than any other community. People who weren't even criminals. They were selling, they were entrepreneurs, is what I call them. But they were selling drugs, and they went to jail and became radicalized. We talk about ISIS. We radicalized black and brown communities in jail, and then we want to tell white folks they're evil and they're criminals.
We're now on item number 4, public comment period. We have 14 comment cards. The first 5, Karen Hilfman, Prentice Jenkins, the Chief, Audrey George, and DA.
Department to turn in their guns.
Wait, sit down and listen.
This weekend also.
Yeah. Nah.
Inspired by.
That's your last. That's your last warning, and that's your last warning, and I'll call a recess.
What happened to the first warning?
Steve's in charge.
No more warnings.
You already got the no more warnings.
So thank you. I get a chance again to urge the police department to turn their guns in this weekend also. I was inspired by my colleague Matt McGorry last weekend, who went to the new Jim Crow.
There are now only two commissioners.
So I'm going to start at the
beginning. No, there's three. Never mind.
Introduction. Jarvis Cotton cannot vote. Like his father, grandfather, great-grandfather, and great-great-grandfather, he has been denied the right to participate in our electoral democracy. Cotton's family tree tells the story of several generations of black men who were born in the United States, who were denied the most basic freedom that democracy promises, the freedom to vote for those who will make the rules and laws that govern one's life. Cotton's great-great-grandfather could not vote as a slave. His great-grandfather was beaten to death by the Ku Klux Klan for attempting to vote. His grandfather was prevented from voting by Klan intimidation. His father was barred from voting by poll taxes and literacy tests. Today, Jarvis Cotton cannot vote because he, like many black men in the United States, has been labeled a felon and is currently on parole. Cotton's story illustrates, in many respects, the old adage, the more things change, the more they remain the same. In each generation, new tactics have been used for achieving the same goals. Goals shared by the founding fathers. Denying African-American citizenship was deemed essential to the formation of the original nation. Hundreds of years later, America is still not an egalitarian democracy. The arguments and rationalizations that have been trotted out in support of racial exclusion and discrimination in its various forms have changed and evolved, but the outcome has remained largely the same.
Thank you. Next.
Thank you, Stephen. Good morning. Peace between residents and police. Good morning, my residents overall. Good morning, board. I'd like to say that peace between residents and police is moving forward, and that's simply because of what I call the wise man that lives upon the mountain. I go up and ask that wise man questions sometimes. I ask him whether the peace between residents and police is will be achieved, he says. I ask him, will the police department, will it put its hand in there? And I also ask him, will they renew my favorite program, TV program, Blue Bloods, next year? He says yes to all of those. He's a very wise man. I appreciate his support. I saw something last week coming across the street from 2nd and Main. There were two police officers talking to each other, waiting on a light. And one police officer decided to walk across the street on a red light. And the other police officer stood waiting on the green light. So what that tells me is one police officer behaved very immature, like a child, and he looked back to see if the other police officer was going to follow him. But the mature police officer understood that this is a broken windows theory. If you use broken windows on the community, you can also use broken windows on the police. If you allow police officers to just start walking across the street on red lights and everybody's watching, then what is that saying to the public? What does that say to the public? That the public is saying, well, we don't need to obey the law either if a police officer can. I applaud the police officer who stood there and waited for the green light.
Good point.
Parker, the Red Chief Hunt, Audrey George, and DA.
Police agent is trying to make us look bad.
I guess the mic on this. My First Amendment right is getting the mic on this. I was selling soap. Yes, yes, yes. That's just the beginning. Like I said, I'm going to take on LAPD since I'm down here. I'm going to charge him, and I'm going to charge Chief Beck and hold him accountable. I'm going to take him to the United States District Court and get his ass out of here. And you guys ain't got shit to say because you guys are part of the problem, not the solution. So if you're not part of the problem, the solution, so you guys, be careful what you do.
I wanted to speak about Measure C, Charter Amendment C. I see it as like a mathematical equation where it's made up of two components, the police union and Mayor Garcetti's ambitions. The political future. I look at this police commission charged with accountability, holding the LAPD accountable. I don't know any scripture, but one time Pastor Q came and said something that meant so much to me to hear about those of you who are given power and what is required of you. What is required of you is to do your job. How you could not be opposing Measure C is just beyond me. And Cynthia McLean Hill, I was just so disappointed that your name is attached to that measure as well. Not just are you not opposing it, but it appears you are supporting it and had a hand it maybe in writing it. When the Board of Rights finally decides to fire Kevin Ferguson, for instance, that officer who acted so inappropriately in Anaheim and showed no impulse control or good judgment, are we going to really let him off? Are we going to really let him go, choose his punishment, choose the body that will decide his punishment? I would love to hear how any of you could support Measure C and how you could have supported the way it was put on the ballot without. You know, there it sits with no rebuttal. There it sits as though the whole city agrees that it's a good thing. I'm appalled, and I will be appearing tonight to tell people at the City Hall of my feelings as well.
Is there a Jade on
I'll
the
look
comments?
Like Kai, Joy T, and Eddie H.
Is there a Jade on there, Maria?
Next speaker, please.
Thank you.
Greetings, my name is DA. I'm a local Rastafarian
few weeks ago, Dr. Abdul's daughters correctly said that the hostile, disinterested commissioners don't know no better but to act the way that they do. Historically, black mothers have often insisted that their kids don't sass. That is a moral philosophy that values maturity and experience. It emphasizes the humility in belonging to something intangible that is greater than you. It teaches us that we are not each the center of the world like a child or like a racist does. Egotistical Nazis said that their Third Reich would last 300 years, but actually only lasted 12 years. George Wallace, the Southern Sheriff, segregationist, was shot and handicapped and discriminated against as a wheelchair-bound person, and thereby humbled such that he eventually renounced segregation. He learned better and improved his moral character. A crocodile in a habitat in Bulawayo, Zimbabwe, in southeastern Africa during the 1980s had eaten three people, and yet was allowed to live. In African cultures, man is seen as being a part of a whole, not as being the center of the world. Many elderly white Trump voters like the idea of being powerful, like the 1%, knocking black people off of Obamacare, but need their Medicaid, and are not willing to give up their lives in order to be a part of the great white man mythology. The egotism of white supremacy is valueless. If you are trying to grow your empire quickly, there is an efficiency to being crude and nihilistic. He needs a certain black American father, in a particular incident, would not defend his own 7-year-old son after the little boy had been disrespected by a racist white lady. Instead, the man cowered like a slave from the 1800s, saying nothing to support his own young son. Muhammad Ali versus Joe Frazier's cultural divide in black America separates those with self-respect like Ali from those like Frazier who ignore personal moral responsibility out of a creepy historic fear. Racists and slaves alike are both lacking philosophic foundation. An historic parallel exists in the Jewish people who taught much philosophy to Native Europeans who didn't know no better. The ancient and often humbling history of Jewish people made that possible. Currently, Attorney General Jeff Sessions is someone who does not have the intellectual capacity to be able to understand morality. Other racist policing supporters include poor whites and people of color.
Thank you.
Who work for the LAPD, supporting the richest 1% of the society, who collectively engage in the forced underdevelopment of minority communities, and then arresting the people affected by that underdevelopment. These various LAPD employees support this destructive and unstable plan because they don't know no better. Get up, stand up against the ignorance of groupthink. No ban, no wall, no stop and frisk. No ban, no wall, no stop and frisk. No ban, no wall, no stop and frisk.
Tyler Toomey, followed by Gracie.
Excuse me, sir.
All these police reform statements by this body of police that addressed this commission for how long are just more cover-ups for past and future crimes committed by LAPD officers with impunity, because the crimes they commit are always with impunity. Technology as body camera will not reform the LAPD. It's just another tool against the community. In recent history, LAPD outlawed the chokehold after mass public outcry. Then troops introduced the taser as a non-lethal, quote, non-lethal. I'd like to see how you would feel being tasered, controlled and repression by police. Rodney King was beaten by four LAPD officers as about 10 or 15 others were in the circle watching, and they clubbed him to the edge of death with over 60 club beatings. And that resulted in the verdict of not guilty in a white police community of all white jurors. And that resulted in the LA 1992 rebellion by all races of people. The authoritarian attitude and tactics of intimidation, together with multiple weapons, clubs, tasers, and guns, and officers' fear of the other,
thank you, sir,
but authoritarian attitude have resulted in multiple murders by LAPD officers with impunity. Body cameras will primarily be used to surveil human rights activists, and the body cameras are not released to the public, so the police will use them at their discretion. It's a farce. More serious.
Jade Daniels and Paul
Miner. Yeah, Eddie, Los Angeles Community Action Network. Let me help you out, Audrey. The quote is, to whom much is given, much is required. And there's a very interesting dynamic that plays out every week in this room. A dynamic of not separatism, but a dynamic of interconnectedness between the police, chief of police, and the police commissioners. We just saw Matt Johnson leave with the chief of police. I was here a couple of weeks ago, and I got in the room early, and they were laughing and joking and patting each other on the back and for 10 minutes. And I sat there, and I was thinking, there has to be some type of connection in order to laugh and joke for 10 minutes like they were. So how can you do your job in policing the chief if you have that connection with them? Yeah, but that not only goes for Matt Johnson, but it goes for the rest of you commissioners as well. And I want to call you out, Shane, of course. We had a meeting with you at LA Can a couple months ago. And at that meeting, you expressly told us, well, don't let this conversation get out. And I know why. Because your performance was sad and pathetic. You showed us your lack of intellect, intelligence, and knowledge of what's really going on. And if I was you, I wouldn't want to get out of here. But it's time for you to pay up. Because we had some things, and we demanded some things of you, and you said that you would make two of those demands. But at this point in time, you have done nothing but come into this room week after week and sit there like a knot on a log. And we're calling you out. Because we told you if our demands are not met, we're going to ask for your resignation. So I'm asking for your resignation today, Shane Goldsmith. Go back to where you work, because they accept you with all your inequalities and inequities.
Next speaker.
But we're not going to accept you anymore. Coming here week after week, doing nothing.
Christine Gatson. Yeah.
Seems to be a concerted effort to discourage people, the community, citizens, from speaking, not necessarily by telling them that they can't, but by small things like only letting three people at a time come into the lobby to go through a bag search so that we can get into this room, with the excuse of, oh, the meeting hasn't started yet, letting other people come into the building, oh, but they have other business. We are here for business, too. It is absolutely ridiculous that we are being made to wait while other people come into the building so that we miss the beginning of the meeting, can't get our comment cards in on time. It's ridiculous and it's unfair.
Right.
Illegal.
It is a form of intimidation, just like having cops line this room. Since there seems to be some confusion on your parts about the importance of free speech, I'm going to reread a portion of a letter that the ACLU sent you a couple of years ago. Should take some time on your own and review the whole thing. Nowhere is the fundamental right to free speech and expression more vital than when addressing public officials regarding issues of public concern. In fact, citizens have an enormous First Amendment interest in directing speech about public issues to those who govern their city or police force. It is only through free debate and free exchange of ideas that government remains responsive to the will of the people and peaceful change is affected. In recognition of these interests, the California legislature enacted California's open meetings law. The Brown Act states that legislative bodies in the state exist to aid in the conduct of the people's business. We have business here, and we should be let in the same order as we arrive, We should not be held back while other people who have other business that you don't have a problem with get to come into the building.
Thank you.
Thank you. Followed by Paula Miner and Gina DiPietro.
Okay, so my first post-college experience with civic engagement have largely been formed working to protect communities from the harm, trauma, exploitation, and continual repression of the LAPD. My latest is working every day to make hundreds of phone calls to the people of the city of LA to let them know about Charter Amendment C and that it is on the ballot next Tuesday, May 16th. Most of them have no idea. For those of you who aren't sure what Measure C is, once Charlie Beck, who left, finds an officer guilty of misconduct, which rarely happens, but once he does, he can recommend a disciplinary action. So that officer can appeal that disciplinary action with the Board of Rights. As of right now, it is comprised of two officers and a civilian, and the charter amendment will give that officer an option to have another board comprised of all civilians and no officers. Of course, looking further into it, as always in this city and in this country, the only people that will benefit from the civilian board will be the dirty cops and not their victims. Their definition of civilian are only those that have had at least 7 years arbitration and mediation experience. So those are all prosecutors, judges, and lawyers.
Yeah.
People who have been working with police every day, and they are not reflective of our communities. They also cannot even be considered until they have a private interview with the executive director of the police commission, who is Mr. T. Fink, who I watched lie, not once, not twice, but several times, on the stand against a civil rights icon and one of my mentors. So it is definitely not very comforting to see that you will be in charge of screening those that will be bringing some accountability to us. And since you are so far up their ass, it must have been nighttime for your entire career. Lastly, looking at the last 6 years, the civilian has shown to be more lenient on the officer every single time.
Yes.
There is a case where an LAPD officer was found guilty of publicly masturbating, and the civilian on that board voted to have him return to our streets, patrol our communities, and be around our children. So this measure is nefarious indeed. I also was surprised that the only two non-elected officials that support this amendment are our very own commissioners, Cynthia and Sandra. Cynthia, I was very excited to see another black woman join this board and maybe listen to hear us and actually maybe bring some accountability and maybe at the very least do your job. Mm-hmm. But I'm saddened to see and must question if you wrote and passed this as a lobbyist and got paid to do so. Mm-hmm. You are legitimate. You all are legitimate, and I yearn for the day that you all are out of a job.
Say, are you racist enough? Are you racist?
Lied on the stand.
Follow the microphone.
Put you on there. Are you racist enough?
Wow.
You failed to see.
My comments are also on Measure C. Black Lives Matter, ACLU, Stop LAPD Spying, LA Can, Community Concern, Scope, and many other community groups are against Measure C.
Yeah.
And I want to remind everyone that there is finally a public hearing on Measure C tonight, 6 o'clock, downtown, City Hall, to be very convenient for the community. I mean, this is the only public hearing, and it's for the entire city of Los Angeles, and it is downtown in City Hall. And it is also 1 week before the election. So they really want to hear from the community. And I agree with the previous speakers. I believe there's a question when you, Cynthia, one of our commissioners, are one of the authors of Measure C. But then you are collaborating with the police union to formulate the language for that particular measure while still holding an alleged oversight position as a commissioner. And again, I say alleged because in many cases, our commissioners appear to simply be a conduit or rubber stamp for whatever it is that LAPD decides to do. We also question whether or not you were a paid lobbyist. That's the word, of course, on the street. And if, again, that doesn't raise some kind of question of ethics. Again, we are against Measure C, and we have great questions that the people who are practicing oversight, and I do say practicing oversight with LAPD, are very instrumental in the development and the support of Measure C.
Yeah.
Gina DiPietro, followed by Jeremy Ray.
Got it.
Thank you, Commissioners. I'm Gina DiPietro, and I want to thank you so much for what you do and your service to the community. And thank you also to the LAPD for having the beautiful memorial wall that they have and the event that they had to thank those officers who sacrificed their lives for our safety. So God bless you and
sacrifice
God bless them.
Sacrifice our lives, not their lives. Yes.
Just go ahead and lift their boots. It's easier.
I'm not particularly a fan of de-escalating. I'm not a particularly fan of saying that we need to keep time and distance and communication always a priority, because we don't really know.
Black lives, they matter here.
Black lives, they matter here.
Black lives, they matter now.
Black lives, they matter now.
Black lives, they matter here.
Black lives, they matter here.
Black lives, they matter now.
Black lives, they matter now.
Black lives, they matter here.
Black lives, they matter here.
Black lives, they matter now.
Black lives, they matter now.
Black lives, they matter here.
Black lives, they matter here.
Black lives, they matter now.
Black lives, they matter now.
Black lives, they matter here.
Black lives, they matter here.
Black lives, they matter now.
Black lives, they matter now.
Black lives, they matter here.
Black lives, they matter here.
Black lives, they matter now.
Black lives, they matter now.
Markeisha Wilson, say hello.
Markeisha Wilson.
Markeisha Wilson, say hello.
Markeisha Wilson.
Brother Africa, say his name.
Brother Africa.
Brother Africa, say his name.
Brother Africa.
Closed session to discuss items number.
I got a public comment.
You got public comments left.
Remember, folks, you're accountable for what you actually do, not what you pretend to do. Peace.
Don't be afraid of us, Cynthia. We ain't tripping on you no more. We know who you are. We ain't tripping on you. God will handle that. God will handle that in ancestors. We ain't got time to tread on you. We know who you are. We didn't know who you are.
We ain't got time for that. And that's the time to keep that time.
Why was so good? Why was so good?
We'll just show you who we are. We'll prove to you who we are.
Commissioner Hill. You're taking care of the laws, right?
Yeah, quit fucking with her. Just let her fuck ass.